here's an interview in form of a questionnaire that I gave Marco Minneman. Marco really needs no introduction. He's a drummer who has worked with Joe Satriani, Paul Gilbert, Steve Haggett, Stephen Molson, Mike Keneally, Trey Gunn, Nick Beggs, The Sea Within, Continuum, Pliny, and The Bohemian Day. His own bands, The Aristocrats and McStine-Minnemann, creates music that is always filled with diverse stories, fireworks, and surprises. His own solo albums also have featured Alex Lifeson from Rush. According to Joe Satriani's website, he even possesses a superpower, animal. This interview was set up around the time of Marco's 50th birthday. I want to personally thank Marco for sharing his time and insight. Marco's best known for his drumming, and I've had the fortunate opportunity to work with his drum parts intimately. But he is an exceptional guitar player and a gifted creative writer, composer, that I feel should be talked more about by everyone. So many of the questions on those fronts are by design, since I feel those skills make up to what an incredible, complete musician that he is. So here he is, Marco Minneman.
Well, hello there, Marco Minneman here, live, or meanwhile I guess pre-recorded, from my house here in Lake Elsinore / music studio. Tonight, I have the pleasure answering some questions from Lucas Lee, unique composer, great guitar player, and I had the pleasure on being featured on two of his albums so far, and I hope this continues. We became dear friends, you know, he comes to our shows, he's a lovely guy, always like, you know, very cool conversations, very thoughtful and very elaborate musician and personality. So, elaborate personality, that's something, isn't it? So, anyways, I'm kind of getting derailed here. Maybe I gotta, you know, ask my friend Glenn Fittich, who's 18 years old, almost old enough to drink itself, in certain countries actually very much is already. So I'm gonna take a sip of that and then we start the interview. How about that? Cheers, everyone. Okay, holy cow. It's gonna last a while. All right, here we go. Let's start. Here's the foreword. Hey, Marco. These are questions that I've always had and have been curious about. Stuff that I've always wished other interviewers have asked more. Okay, I'm ready. Now that I get to ask them myself, I'm going all in. By all means, do. We'll talk approach and philosophy before going into gear, including non-drum related gear. Drums, arrangement. Okay, let's first talk drumming and arrangement. One of the things I always hear in your playing with other artists is that the parts you play always sound cohesive and make the song sound as if you wrote the song together with the artist. Thank you kindly for that compliment. I guess this is like, you know, artist, when an artist gives me freedom and it's just joy to express yourself. So you don't feel boxed in, you know, otherwise you feel like a tiger in the cage, you can't move. So I always welcome that and thank you for pointing that out. As in the case with the Aristocrats too, where each member writes and produces their own three songs per album. Yeah, the arrangement and the songs always feel as if they are written as a unit. Now, with the Aristocrats, it might not be a fair example because every member of the band are very capable producers and are insanely awesome, thank you kindly, experienced performers. I'm not a drummer, so my apologies for not knowing the technical details, but what do you think attributes to this sixth sense? When you ask your contributors, is it entirely based on your instinct? If it's instincts, has it always been that way? Or is this based on your musical vocabulary built up from listening to all sorts of genres of music? Maybe developed over decades of playing? That was a long question. That's a long question, Lucas. But I know exactly where you're going with this, and there is a certain sixth sense. There's like, you know, this intuition, there's like, you know, this chemistry, I would call it. And we certainly have that with the Aristocrats. And when we write music for our studio albums, we write for each other, if that makes sense. So, yes, we write the songs, like you rightfully said, like 3 songs per record of each member. But what we do is, like, we try not to box in the players to kind of, obviously, if there's unison parts, they have to be performed in unison. But sound, structure, texture of the individual players should be absolutely interpreted by themselves. And so we do keep kind of space, you know, obviously for solo spots or for like certain, you know, fills, you know, and musical attributions, or what you say is like, you know, like variations, you know. So these should be unique. But there is like the certain thing. I remember, like, you know, when we first met in the studio and we rehearsed for the show that we first planned, Guthrie, Brian and myself, there was immediately this unbelievable lock, you know, that we had. We started playing and it felt instantly, you know, good and just, you know, spontaneous, daring, but safe, I would say. So we never really, when we are on stage, have an insecurity factor or something, right? You know, I always say, like, if a guitar rig goes down or like a snare head breaks or a guitar string or something, 2 of us could carry, you know, like, you know, that time. There's never like, you know, a spot where you kind of think like, oh my God, you know, these guys are struggling or something. We have like a certain chemistry that is very strong and powerful. And I guess it got manifested over the years and only kind of strengthened. So, yes, basically, it comes with experience, obviously, but there was already a great chemistry there from the get-go. Okay, let's go on to the next question. What advice would you have for young musicians that want to develop this kind of sensitivity in their playing? Well, good question, actually. First of all, listen to each other. Don't make it about yourself. Make it about the entity. Make it about the band. You know, you want to kind of, and this is good when you write songs. If you're a songwriter, I can only recommend, pick up other instruments so that you also know where the importance lies. You know, like when you kind of play a guitar riff, don't solo over it with drums. You know, let the instrument speak, you know, where it wants to be spoken, where it wants to speak, where it wants to talk. And so everybody has, you know, their moments to shine. When that moment arrives, be supportive. When your moment arrives to shine, that's when you can let go. And so I can only give the advice, listen to what's important in the song. If it's a groove-driven song, don't overplay, all right? If it's like, you know, bebop, jazz or whatnot, yeah, play ghost notes on the drums, you know, do some crazy fills or whatnot. But go back to the core. If there's like a melody that needs to be played and featured, stay out of the way. So this is an advice I can really kind of, you know, give. So, you know, and when you listen to your favorite bands, you know, pick the importance of the parts that are being listened to by yourself right now, at the moment. So if I listen to a Queen record or something, it's kind of, you know, song that everybody knows, Bohemian Rhapsody, has complexity in it, but the message is very clear. You know, you hear the lyrics, you hear what they say. There's like the piano part that is featured, and then the operatic section is a whole different kind of thing. That's when other voices come in, and, you know, and then the metal part kicks in at some point, which is then very defined and focused, and then it goes actually back in ease and, well, you know, basically dribbles out. Not dribbles out, it's a fantastic ending. But so it's important, you know, that you listen to the parts and feature the parts that want to be featured with respect. Here we go. This brings us to musical influences. I know you're a fan of Led Zeppelin, Queen, The Police, Rush and Frank Zappa. I'm aware that you also listen to FX Twin. But what are some other music that others might less expected that you enjoyed listening to growing up? You can include lesser known artists too. Well, there are many artists, you know, that I listen to, not only the ones that I mentioned, you know, but, you know, obviously I grew up also listening to Jethro Tull, to Iron Maiden, to Judas Priest, to Kate Bush. Ryuichi Sakamoto, one of my favorite composers. I love Prince. Kraftwerk, electronic band. Even Kiss, somebody would not expect me to say, but when I was a kid and Alive 1 came out, I was like 5 years old or something. I was like, woo. Actually, I was 4 years old when that album came out. But, you know, these are things, you know, that still matter. I had a metal phase as well, you know, like we just kind of discussed with Priest, for example. I still like that band. I played actually with Necrophages, death metal band, and with Creator, which is a thrash metal band. I still actually play a lot of metal. Terry Syrek recently, I did like an album, which was with, you know, Witherfall, the new album. I'm featured on that. What other bands? Pink Floyd, nothing wrong with them, right? You know, AC/DC. Battles is a great newer band. Check them out. Really interesting. Field Music, We Became Dear Friends, great band. Recently, I listened to some excerpts of The Cardiacs. That was actually pretty cool, too. Jethro Tull said there's nothing wrong with that either, right? You know, fantastic band. XTC. Well, you know, we could go on and on and on. Now I'm kind of just blabbering that whole stuff out as it comes. But yeah, those are some of the artists I appreciate a lot. Cheers to all of them. What type of albums are played during travels with the Aristocrats? I know the song Big Money by Rush was played at some point, as well as Ween. That's true. What other music is in the rotation? And what should you currently recommend? Who gets to play DJ while on the road? Okay, believe it or not, we hardly listen to music while we're traveling. It's a rare occasion that some music happens in the van. But we did have a Ween phase, and it was very cool, you know, because, you know, we totally went into the rabbit hole and kind of, you know, listened to all sorts, of the albums, because they're like so diverse and so funny. So it's entertaining, isn't it? We did listen a little bit to Rush. We did listen to Queen. We did listen to Zeppelin. Yeah, you know, and on and off, you know, some other stuff came in. What did the others play? Knower is a band called Knower, and I kind of, you know, remember a few songs, but yeah, that was kind of cool as well. I don't know, it didn't resonate with me as much as with the others. Sorry, maybe I have to listen a little more. But yeah, Ween was our biggest phase, where we just got in the van and go like, okay, let's experience, you know, the next album, and we would laugh our asses off and have fun. Okay. From a recent interview, as the duo McStine-Minnemann, I heard that part of the initial spark came when you both met and started talking about different bands that you listened to. What are some of the specific musical tastes that you both share, particularly ones not related to progressive experimental music? Well, see, Randy and I, we don't really identify ourselves a lot as really prog musicians. I mean, what is prog anyways, right? You know, the stereotypical, you know, progressive band with, you know, fantasy covers and dwarves dancing around a Christmas tree and in the forest and singing about elves and the wide ocean and secret mountains and forests. No, those are not our topics. But we do work with people from the prog world, and so therefore, you know, we even met in this sort of house, which is fine, totally cool. You know, there's nothing wrong with it. I played with Steve Hackett from Genesis, which is kind of a prog band, isn't it? And it was so much fun. Great songs, fantastic player, and the whole band, fantastic players. And I just had a great time with them. Anyhow, I'm going to detour here right now. So, yeah, different, you know, we mostly talk about other music, really, you know. So we don't really talk about a collection of Jethro Tull or Yes albums, even though I kind of don't really think that Jethro Tull are so much prog, you know. I think they're more like, you know, folk rock. Yes, they were kind of a pretty proggy band, right? Or are, you know, they're still around, right? Anyhow, we talked about Public Image Limited, for example, one of both of our favorite bands, around John Lydon, you know, who's also Johnny Rotten, known as him. And I think, you know, Pill were really doing something quite unique, you know, and always kind of going into directions, you know, one would not think, you know, they would go or something. I like the surprise, you know, I like surprises in music. And so we completely agreed on that one, you know. And I remember, like, when the first McStine-Minnemann album came out, we were sort of drawing influences, you know, from The Police, Frank Zappa, but also from the punk, you know, environment, like Public Image Limited. But then again, the bands we also both listen to are like bands like Judas Priest. We kind of, you know, just geek out about their early albums, or, you know, Michael Schenker albums, UFO, for example, as well. Or, you know, talking about Zeppelin albums as well. We pretty much, you know, speak the same musical language, and Black Sabbath, for example, right? You know, that kind of stuff. So yeah, Randy and I are surprisingly, well, you know, in sync when it comes to music that nobody would expect we kind of would listen to or name as our influences, you know. So maybe that kind of, you know, explains why we have such a great chemistry as well. Okay, and then, bum, 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 bum. I know you mentioned in interviews that while guitar serves mostly as a writing tool and something you adapted to and learned on as needed basis, that's true, to illustrate what's in your head. Well put. But drums was something you really dedicated time on learning and getting as much knowledge as you could. In other interviews and clinics that I've watched of Guthrie's, one of the common questions that would come up would be the things such as music theory and technical chops. Guthrie would say that he would subscribe to the thinking that it's always good to have a bit more headroom than what's needed. What would you say would be your take and your personal thinking approach, or thinking slash approach? I absolutely agree, and I kind of quoted the same statement pretty much as Guthrie. I'd probably be hanging too much, you know, together. The thing is, I do like exactly this kind of thing, that you have more knowledge, which kind of gives you more horsepower, yeah, headroom, horsepower, to kind of, you know, feel comfortable by executing what's needed. You know, there's nothing worse when you hear a band playing at their, you know, absolutely like at all cylinders and like firing, you know, just do this. Like if anything else happens, you know, the machine would explode. That's how it sounds like, just playing at their, you know, basically, how do you say, like, at their limit, if that makes sense. So you need to kind of have, you know, the let's say, you know, you need to have ultimate horsepower, or like as much knowledge as you can get, to then kind of execute, like I said, with ease and with passion, not running the risk of overthinking while you're playing, and executing with comfort. So I absolutely agree of knowing the alphabet inside out to form as many words and as much diversity that you can express with as possible. And drums are the instruments I'm actually virtuous with. I can just improvise and do stuff. Guitar, I have chops, I can do things there as well, but I use it more as a composing tool, and then when I kind of record, yeah, I do overdubs and do things and do one part again and again and until it's perfect, and, you know, the sound and the tone and everything like that. Drums, I can express myself pretty instant and freely. Ace Freely. It was lame enough. Okay, next question. In your various collaborations with Alex Lifeson, Canadian, eh? You said, that was you writing it as well. It's good though. What was the writing process like? Well, you know, Alex and I, we met actually a few times, you know, through a thing when I played with a band called UK, Eddie Jobson. Those guys, you know, he was invited as a guitar player, but he didn't have time to do it. They were just going out with Rush by the time. Then I ran into him a second time, and he contributed to guitars on my album Borrego. And then we kind of took it further, and I started writing a song which was called Lover's Calling, which ended up on one of my solo albums, which is called My Sister. And we started writing the song together then. You know, I kind of sent him the whole skeleton and left a lot of space for him to paint on. Like a, basically like a huge canvas, you know, just like with basic ideas. And he felt very comfortable kind of going like, wow, this is cool. I can stretch out. And then we started collaborating. That was fantastic. Alex is a very musical player. And he's also, it's kind of one of those things, right? You know, you send him the song and he sends the guitars back and everything is holy. If you know what I mean. Everything is like, Alex Lifes is sending guitars back. You know, you respect it instantly. You go like, and then you hear like a tone that sounds a bit like Russian. You go like, oh my gosh, you know, that's totally him. But it is that way. And so I treated it obviously with ultimate respect. There was hardly anything I needed to fix and wanted to fix. It was just great. So it came, the collaboration happened actually in a very organic and friendly way. I think, you know, that's all I can say. One of his guitar tones, like his landscapes, are also featured on our new album, McStine-Minnemann 2, which we are very proud of, Randy and I. And on the last song, which is called The Horse is Dead, there's like this beautiful landscape, you know, that he painted, you know, with like this Fernandez Sustainer guitar he has. Sounds hauntingly beautiful. I love it. You know, it just really expressed the right feel for that tune. So let's do the next thing. Would you ever consider writing a song with keyboards filling up the mid-range all over the place before sending it to him as a fun prank? I guess you're hinting at that Alex was probably reluctant to basically accept a lot of keyboard written songs, you know, which were actually, I think, Rush, you know, in the mid 80s, when Geddy Lee was experimenting with keyboard sounds and wanted to kind of bring in more keyboards. Alex at some point felt reluctant, really. And I think, you know, Counterparts was the album where he kind of where he put his foot down, or, you know, a hand on the table and goes like, look, you know, we need to make a guitar driven or like a rock album again. No, I didn't do this. So that answered the question pretty much, right? A lot of musicians, producers, and engineers, while taking a break during downtown, no music is being listened to. Yeah. I know when you're off tour, you're often involved in album projects, various sessions, and also your own solo productions. But when the day is over, do you feel a need to take a break, or is it something that you just can't get enough of? Hell yes, I don't listen to music all the time. As soon as I'm done, when I record it, the last thing I'm gonna do is like sitting down and listen to more music. It would be like, you know, working in a restaurant, you know, and then later on talking about food when the shift is over or something like that, right? You know, no, absolutely not. I love actually listening to not listen to music on and off. But again, when I'm not on tour and I have like a few, you know, days off and I kind of, you know, just drive somewhere and explore a little bit of nature or do kind of stuff. And yeah, if there's something that I'm interested in music wise, I listen. Lyrical writing is something that's completely foreign to me. Oh, how do you go about doing that? Aside from a little help with alcohol, as you have shared via social media. Did I really say that? Well, now I have a little alcohol, and you know, the emphasis is on a little alcohol. And it's sometimes cool if you're inspired, you know, and you have like a topic you want to write about and you have like a little sip of something, obviously not getting hammered, because then it doesn't do good for anyone. And but lyrics are very, very important to me. For example, like songs I post now from our McStine-Minnemann adventures, you hear me often talk about the lyrics, you know, because if it's a song already, it says it itself, a song, it's about lyrics. So it's kind of the opposite, it's like contraire, you know, to the Aristocrats right now, what we're doing with Randy together, right? So McStine-Minnemann is like very lyrical driven, and also my solo albums are. And if I have something to talk about, then the music gets better along with it. It's like, because you create a vibe, it's almost like a cinematic experience. So sometimes you need inspiration, and it comes sometimes, you know, as a cry from the depth of your soul, if you have something important to say, or if you're hurting, if you went through a breakup, for example. Or, you know, like on the album My Sister, where everything was written about, like, the lives of people, actually, I met, you know, when touring or around here in the Inland Empire in dive bars, and there were so many, you know, stories about broken families, drugs, job losses, all sorts of things where you go like, oh my gosh, I had no idea. It was like, you know, always when you come off the road, you know, when you kind of see these things and you go like, I should dive into this and make maybe some things better in the world by expressing my feelings about this, and maybe people hear it, you know. Your voice always gets heard, but because when you're on the road, what are you going to write about? Like a fun hang, you know, and the girl you met last night, and, you know, some drinks you had with your buddies. No, there's so much more to it, right? And especially on McStine-Minnemann 2, the album I'm very, very proud of, and Randy is too. We both had so many important things to say. It was like him being very politically involved and observant about situations in the world. So was I, but also I formed during the pandemic a relationship which was a fantastic chemistry. I was so in love with this one girl, but then we also saw it falling apart during the pandemic, because you kind of, you meet and all of a sudden you have no chance to really travel and kind of, you know, go out, and you just basically, hi, here I am. We already kind of met earlier. Now we Skyped a few times, and now we meet and kind of live together instantly. Which was sort of a recipe for disaster, especially if both people are kind of opinionated as we are. It's all me. I'm the bad guy. I'll take it. No, I don't know. I think we both actually have qualities, you know, but also really were doing this quite a bit, you know. Very headstrong people with our own opinions, but our chemistry was amazing. It's actually a shame that this broke up. So I had a lot of material, obviously, to write about. And it was not like sobby love songs. It was just like, oh my God, my heart is broken or something like that. No, absolutely not. It was more like about the social experience and the psychological experience. How to work things out, you know, how to get along, you know, listening to each other, working things out, you know. It's a learning curve, you know, and I don't think I actually ever really wrote something like this that intensely, but great topics came out of me. It was almost like as if something spoke through me. I didn't even need to work for it. It just came out. All the things I wanted to say all of a sudden just were flowing out of me, you know, and they were like, they were so diverse that it benefited actually for the music cause actually as well. So everything, you know, that was kind of, you know, written along with the lyrics had such a diversity. You hear like, you know, jazz tunes, you hear like, you know, rock tunes, you hear like, you know, some proggy elements, you hear like pop elements, you hear like in The Horse Is Dead, which is one of my favorite songs from that chapter, which is like very dark and has like, you know, this really, you know, almost like a spaghetti western meets dark electronic pop meets tribal, you know, approaches, you know. So there is like a wide palette, and songs like Hello Dear Miss Swans, Miss Swan song, which is just a tongue-in-cheek funny little bit with a little dig, you know. And then there's like a song with an album title called Quarantine Sex Slave, and the song is deeper than the title, I tell you that. It's a whole journey. And then Randy had like just amazing songs as well. So those were actually some of my songs I just mentioned. And then Randy contributed songs like Old Sparky and Dum Dum, which is fantastic. I love these tunes. And Big Wave, which is a fantastic pop tune. He should kind of go into the lyrical details. Yeah, and my songs were more like, you know, something like The Flame, Hello Dear Miss Swan Song, The Horse Is Dead, and Distant Bodies, and a bunch of other songs, you know. You can go into that, you know. But Yeah, you know, thanks for asking that question. Lyrics are very, very important. There's nothing worse if you have, like, you know, great music and really silly lyrics. So, I Don't Feel is another one, which is kind of cool, I guess. We have the alcohol part. We went into that, didn't we? Okay, and now your music writing is always intriguing. Oh, thank you. And I always love that there's a story, an arc to them. Thanks so much. There are always things to discover along, like a journey. The song Spiritus Cactus of the last, the latest Aristocrats album is a great example. Thanks. When I listened to it the first time, there was the unexpected left turn that made me go, whoa, okay, this is cool. Cheers. During the writing process, how do these left turns come about? How much of it is a concerted effort, and how often these happen due to happy accidents? Or does it come naturally and instinctively? Do the ideas come in one stream of thought, or do you ever need to let the song sit a while and come back to it another time, or at another time? Some songs have that kind of thing, you know, where you write and then you have in your head what you want to express. And then there's, like, you know, some hurdles and you go like, why can't I kind of get further? Why isn't there, like, you know, a part that really works? These songs you sometimes have to let sit, you know, and then kind of, you know, maybe they grow on you, and maybe at a later point you revisit and they go like, actually I do have the answer. It was just not in my head at that time. And then there are songs that kind of, you know, just flow out instantly. Like, for example, Spiritus Cactus. That was a good example. That one I wrote in Florida, actually, in Clearwater. I was on the road with Steve Hackett, The Sea Within, and In Continuum. We did this thing called The Cruise to the Edge. And before that, I was in Bangladesh? No, I was rehearsing with Steve Hackett by that time for the tour. And then basically went, okay, I had to be on the cruise, Cruise to the Edge, and then on the Blue Cruise, which kind of, you know, took off from Florida. So instead of going from the rehearsals from England back to California and then go actually back to the East Coast, I kind of took a flight straight, you know, from England to the East Coast, and then started writing material for the latest Aristocrats album, well, now latest, which is called You Know What. And so I timed it pretty much, you know, I had to learn the material, you know, for the shows, but then I also had to write the material, you know, for our new album. It was an insane time. And so I decided to go like, look, I'm gonna book myself into this hotel for 2 weeks. And I'm going to come up with 3 songs for the new Aristocrats album and learn the other material I have to play on those cruises on this side. I don't know how I did it, but it worked. And even kind of, you know, pretty comfortably, I kind of made myself a schedule. You know, I kind of, you know, started in the morning to learn 2 songs, go to lunch, learn another 2 or 3 songs, and then actually kind of, you know, at 5 in the afternoon, start writing music until 10 or 11 at night. And Spiritus Cactus literally kind of, you know, happened when I kind of was walking on the street, and I heard like this melody inside of my ba da 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 ba da 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 ba 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 ba, right? You know, and then I had this like with those half steps, and so I wanted to make it sort of an Arabic kind of, you know, sounding, but, you know, with a different groove kind of feel, you know, experience, you know, so very left field indeed, you know. And then it takes a left turn actually inside of the song as well, which kind of was inspired more, you know, by the serenity and kind of, you know, the view that I had from my hotel room there. There was like all these ships lying around and all those harbor lights coming on and those kind of, it was, so I kind of went into this kind of really, you know, eased out midsection. And that kind of just came as it went. It was like, just like, wow, you know, the idea was that powerful to me and that kind of logical that I could build on top. So that was a quick to write song, even though it has complexity. It was, it had a pace, you know. Okay. When sitting down to write a piece of music, do you write it from start to finish, or do they typically take a while to complete? I get the impression that you have the ability to write quick, given the amount of output you're able to produce in a year, plus all the different tours during the busier years. I remember there was one year when you were on three tours and you still managed to get a couple of albums out. So some songs do take, like we just spoke about it before, what you asked before, they do take a while to complete. It's not always that everything just falls from the sky and is there, you know, like I said, some things you leave sit there for a while, song just happens as you go. But I always keep writing on stuff, so there are many songs, you know, already kind of, you know, saved on my hard drive, so there's no shortage. There are still some things to complete, and then there's new ideas being added to it. And so, see, even if it seems to you or to some that I'm a workaholic or something like that, it's actually not really true that way. It's like, it happens natural to me, you know, it just comes, you know, and I can express these things meanwhile. Other people go to work for 8 hours a day, you know, which is fine, obviously, which is great. Well, I work on music, that's my life. And so it's actually not that much of a, you know, I work maybe 4 to 5 hours a day, you know, on some studio recordings or writing music, and then voila, that's how that really rolls, you know. It's just like that I take it serious. It's not that I'm going to take like months long breaks to kind of go like, screw music for a while and then I come back. No, I'm at it. It's like love. It belongs to my everyday life, you know. And okay, so the next question, writer's block. Do you ever encounter writer's block? If you do, how do you overcome it? Diet, exercise, caffeine, alcohol, rest. Do you ever find that a song could be difficult to continue if you've listened to the existing parts too many times? Maybe similar to auditioning different guitar solos when recording. Oh yeah, where you may lose instinct after the early takes. Yeah, I know what you mean. How do you keep things fresh? How do you stay objective with your productions? You gotta let go. You gotta let go. That's the key. The more releases you have under your belt or under the hood, you know, the more releases you've done, the more the house is built and decorated, you feel more easy kind of changing things around or decorating other rooms, because you don't have to, you're not under pressure to prove yourself. So let go. Don't try too hard to kind of settle, well, one solo could be a little better. That's getting into OCD. Nobody needs that. Do what your first intuition tells you to do. If somehow, you know, you like this one piece of music that you wrote and it felt right, then kind of keep working on it, just refine it, right? And that's the key. So that's also a very good point to keep objectivity. Don't go too much into a rabbit hole with the song. If the song is good, it will speak to you. Sometimes it is, obviously, you know, here's the one thing I do with the objective part, you know. So write the songs, finish them as good as you can, and then take a little break. Let them sit for a while and then come back to them fresh and with a clear head and mind, and then listen to them. And then, you know, you kind of maybe tweak a few things here and there, refine them, all right? Writer's block I don't really encounter, because I write in different directions. If I have said what needed to be said, actually, in regards to a certain topic, then I kind of go to a different style of music. Maybe I write some instrumentals or something. And when there's something to be said lyrically, then I write that down, right? For example, with Minnemann, with McStine-Minnemann 2, that was like one of those things. I had so many topics I wanted to address, because I had a pretty, how can you say that, strange breakup, you know, with my last girlfriend, you know, who was so in love with. I was so in love with this girl. It was great. And even though we were in love with each other, the breakup was kind of more non-spectacular. We kind of went to different cities and just dribbled out. But the most painful part was that we didn't talk. There was, and I actually was reaching out going like, hey, we should actually have a call. And she was, I remember, like, pretty depressed, and she wouldn't want to talk and all this kind of stuff. I go like, wait a minute, but that is not cool. We need to kind of just talk. You need to verbalize things. And it didn't happen. And that was bad. That didn't sit well with me. So I had so many unsolved and unsaid things that were kind of, you know, inside of me. And I had to kind of, you know, work on these alone with myself. And so everything just kept flowing out. I was like, oh my gosh, all of a sudden music became almost like therapeutic in a way, right? Because, you know, yeah, that's the way to describe it. And people deal differently with that. I remember, like, you know, she dealt with being reclusive and I dealt with like, no, actually we need to lay it out. She was kind of just lethargic and depressed. And I was like, no, let it out, because it's better for you. It's better for you to let it out. And so a lot of the songs on the McStine-Minnemann 2 are exactly about that experience. And, like, you know, just dealing and expressing, you know, with things. And I think it's very important. And I remember there was a time when it was done. I remember when I wrote the last piece for that album, I wrote 8 pieces for the album, I think. And Randy wrote 8 pieces, so we shared that. But The Horse's Dead was my last piece for the album I wrote. And then everything was said and done, pretty much. The topic could have been put to rest after that. And then I felt kind of a sort of emptiness, not a writer's block, but it was like, oh, it's out now. I said what I needed to say, what needed to be said, and what I wanted to say. And then all of a sudden, I started writing happier songs, like one which is coming in the next album, which is called I Love My Shark, which is also featured actually meanwhile on social media as a demo version, which is dedicated to one of my best friends actually in Brazil, Carla. We love each other and as friends, and well, you know, we did have a relationship, but we're friends, we're really good friends, and she's just like one of these people you can always talk to, you know, because talking is important, because in my life, everybody stays. You know, there will be no unsaid words or unfinished or some. I would never refuse anyone, you know, to talk or something. So it's very important. And Carla is one of these people you can reach out anytime, and she will respond, and we would bond. And she does the same with me. And so, and she's obsessed with sharks. So I had like a great topic. We always joke about sharks, you know. So I was like, I love my shark, and we swim to Greenland together because it's like a pandemic and stuff. So all of a sudden, all this darkness, you know, turned into light, which is beautiful. Okay, let's kind of move on a little bit. Man, I'm still on the same little sip of whiskey, but I'm enjoying this. I'm a lightweight, am I? Hang on, let me see. Okay, next. Working with Trey Gunn and Mike Keneally. With Trey Gunn and Mike Keneally. They have each released an album, Writing and Playing, oh yeah, that's right, Over Your Drum Solo. I was expecting that, that's true, yeah. Trey Gunn's album called Modulator, I thought. And Mike Keneally's called Evidence of Humanity. Were you involved in that process at all, other than having played and recorded the initial solo? Well, there are many more projects. We all did, actually. Okay, I invited a bunch of musicians. I played a lengthy drum solo, which is about like 40-something minutes long, 45 minutes or so. And then Mike wrote actually an entire album around it. Trey Gunn did. Alex Mahacek, my dear friend Mario Brinkmann, and myself too. And we were not allowed to listen to each other's approach. That was the cool thing, to then just kind of hear, you know, how it all blends together. I called it Normalizer 2, because there's also Normalizer 1, which I initially started as a duo with Mario Brinkmann. But now Normalizer 2, we all separately worked on our versions. And so on purpose, we didn't listen to each other, to our individual approaches. But it was fun to listen to the same thing, you know, coming together around, you know, the contributions coming together, being put on top as pizza ingredients or whatnot, you know, on the same drum solo. You've also worked with them in other projects too. The cool thing about them is that there is always something meaningful and interesting for them to say in their music, true? It's always ferocious and bold. Whether or not the music itself is tonally aggressive. It's the very same in your playing, and you never hear any sort of doubt in the performances. Well, you gotta project security, right? You know, you just know it and do it. But at the same time, you're all present, and there's that special common chemistry, communication thing that is going on, and you are all heading into the same direction. What was it like working with them? Well, it's interesting. I don't think that Trey and Mike, I don't think that we worked actually all together. We worked separately, you know, like with Trey, he was actually part of UK or UKZ, that band with Eddie Jobson, and Alex Malachek was part of it too. Then also John Wetton, bless his soul, rest in peace, a dear friend of mine. And with Mike, I worked together in his band, then also with Joe Satriani. And then we also did like a trio, MKB, which was Minnemann, Keneally, Beller, or KMB, Keneally, Minnemann, Beller. I don't know what we called each other by that time. But, and so that was more an Aristocrats concept where we played, where each of us brought in songs and we played them together. It was great, you know, fantastic. What can I say? Very virtuous and well-rounded, you know, musicians, you know, in many cases of songs and productions, you know, so there's obviously a wisdom and beauty to it. Okay. Your studio. You have worked and tracked in professional studios in many shapes and forms, as well as have your own studio set up for various session projects. Whether there are things you've picked up from other engineers and producers over the years that you incorporated in your own studio music productions. Okay, yeah, you learn. It's a learning curve, absolutely. I remember, like, you know, working at the Principal Studios in Germany, where I learned a lot about miking, close miking, room mics, about the right distances, you know, where air flows, you know, and all this kind of stuff. How to set up a drum set, for example, how to mic a guitar. It's very important when and how to use EQ. Defining the room sound, for example, this room here has like also a bunch of curtains that I can close to make it a little drier, you know, stuff like that. Or setting up the drum set, for example, in the right space. This wall is angled so it doesn't reflect back. That's the reason why I also like the kitchen is over here, which is open, right? So, you know, that the sound kind of goes this way and doesn't project back. And I have curtains over there as well. And, you know, by the end, which I can open either way to get a little bigger sounding room or close. Same as here. So these are kind of, you know, little things you learn. Then I worked actually at the Studio Miraval with Patrice Koeff. It's the studio where I think one of the most known albums was recorded there is The Wall by Pink Floyd. And we got pretty much from that castle. And Patrice was the guy who engineered, you know, the album partially, I think. Yeah, he engineered it for sure. I'm not sure if it was a partial engineering or if he did most of it. You know, Bob Ezrin was the producer. Anyhow, and it has the wall sound. I remember like David Gilmour and those guys recording in this one room and Nick Mason. And you get this drum sound instantly, you know. So it is sort of an importance to pick the right room for the right sounds. And there are many more studios I worked with that are very famous studios, like Air Studios or East West Studios, which used to be, or Ocean Way and Cello Studios. And yeah, East West was good. You know, that was a great, great sounding place too. We did Stephen Wilson's The Raven Refused to Sing. And then we did Hand Cannot Erase at Air Studios. And then the Galaxy Studios, gosh, I worked there actually with Patty Kelly. And then with the Aristocrats, we worked actually at, I forgot what, Sound City, what was it called? Sound City, Sunset Sound, sorry. So that was a very famous studio as well, or is, you know. So we picked like a few cool studios. The Brotherin Studios in Ojai are fantastic studios. We did our last Aristocrats album, You Know What, there. great actually surrounding as well, very peaceful, very cool, you know. And anyhow, yeah, I did also recording sessions there with Simon Phillips, my dear friend. We did sample sessions and also played a bunch of solos. It was really, really cool. Okay, awesome. So, from the deluxe video release, as part of the You Know What Aristocrats album, or maybe Tres Caballeros 2, there were shots of the SSL console. Were those albums mixed on the console? You don't have to answer this if you don't want to. No, I'm happy to do that. We recorded through the consoles, but actually the sessions were mixed by, especially on the last album, by Forrester Savelle in Australia. And he did great sound, absolutely, but I don't think he used an SSL desk. Gear. How many pages are there actually? Jesus Christ. Man. Okay, a lengthy thing here. Alright, cool. I need to take a little break here, sorry. Oh, gear. This may be lost on me, but I'm sure a lot of drummers out there would like to know. Is there anything you can currently share about your signature sticks that you have been playing in your post the last couple of months? Absolutely. Well, I play the 7-2-1s, that's my signature stick, and I designed it. It has like the balance a bit of a 5A, but it has like, you know, a half round tip, I would say. Why is it half round? If it's too round, you destroy the drum heads easily. And it sounds very crisp on the ride cymbal. If you just kind of, you know, file off the edges a little bit, you don't dent the drum heads, but it still sounds crisp on the cymbal. So that was one of the things, you know, it's one of my, well, now not so secret anymore, ingredients of designing the stick. And now we're messing around to delivering that stick in fire grain format, which is like a different roasted wood. It just feels great in your hand, and it also is a little more sturdy. But the Hickory model is still the one. And so we're just kind of, you know, those are, the fire grain sticks are the ones I'm experimenting with right now. Very cool. So let's see. I think you told me back during the summer that you were getting a new snare. Mm-hmm. Is there anything you can say about it? Yes, actually, I was getting this amazing copper snare, whatever it is. Great, great snare drum, sounds fantastic. But then they delivered actually this Purple Heart kit and the snare that comes with it, the plain Purple Heart 14x6, sounds incredible. And I've been using the snare ever since. The end, nothing else to say. It's like one of those things you took out of the box, compared it to other snare drums, listened back and forth and back. It's like, yeah, no, great, nothing else needed. You'll hear that on most of my newest social media videos. Mm. And obviously also on our record, on the recent one. So, most of the videos that I've seen you track in your studio is the DW kit next to the kitchen. But I think you also have another kit in another room, or maybe another electronic kit next to the tube. What are the differences between the kit, or are they similar kits but for specific room tones that you're looking for? The latter one. Upstairs, the kit sounds beautiful. It's a cherry wood kit. But the room is first of all smaller, but has like a little cone, you know, towards, you know, it has like a higher ceiling, a divided ceiling. Almost like a little bit like a chapel or something, you know. It's great. It's a very warm and open sounding room, but it's also intimate, you know. It has like this warmth, you know, and a certain low end that is kind of, you know, very how do you say, like, you know, warm is the right word to describe it, really. And I have been recording recently there as well for the next McStine-Minnemann album. Very different vibe, but the kit here, actually the Purple Heart kit, has everything to offer. The room has everything to offer. With this one being mic'd in the setting as it is, especially if I record also for other artists, that's the one, you know, pretty much most of producers would kind of want, because you can do anything with it you like. You know, you have like so many choices to tweak. So yeah, for my private pleasure, both things absolutely valid. The electronic kit, I mainly use it just, you know, sometimes to mess around with, like, you know, certain sounds and have fun with, you know, or if I feel like, you know, rehearsing some songs, you know, for a band, you know, in the middle of the night or something, you know, or 11 in the evening or something like that, you know, that then I kind of use that and it's easy on the ears. And I have like some other speakers there where I can listen to some songs, make some notes, right? Yeah, there you go. Based on various interviews you've had over the years and social media posts, I think you do have a bit of a guitar collection, yes. I think you own a Marshall, yeah, yeah, JCM 800, which is a modified one, and a Kemper profiling amp. What types of tones do you like on them, and how do you typically use them? Do you have a type of amp, type speaker type, that you gravitate towards? And which Kemper profile sounds are your go-tos? Do you have a preference between real amps versus modelers? Well, I have like a Syrek amp as well, a Badger, which is fantastic. Also with, you know, the head and the cabinet. And I do have a JCM 800, which is modified as well by like a, I forgot this guy's name, really famous guitar amp modifier for all sorts of big bands, you know, so you can kind of get a full on metal tone, but you can also get like, you know, really like, nice clean thing. I guess he modifies the tubes and everything. And yeah, the Kemper. I love the Kemper. You know, there's like many great sounds. Like Michael Britt has found some fantastic amps. He's been designing. Oh, I can't tell you exactly, you know, the go-to ones right now, because there are many variations I use and then I save them, you know. It's like almost I really tweak a lot on these sounds until I'm really happy then. And some are just right there out of the box, and then you kind of go like, oh, cool, just let's put like a little bit of, you know, maybe compression. I intend not to put compression before I, you know, record. That should happen after, you know. So mostly I kind of, you know, use maybe slight a bit of, you know, reverb or delay. Or like, you know, flanger or whatever is needed, you know, or like a phaser. The other amps I can really recommend if you're on the road, if you use Universal Audio Gear, fantastic amps. Absolutely great. Like, you know, the thing called Fuchs, which is a German name, Fuchs, like the Fox 2, that one is fantastic. And furthermore, also for my friends, John Suhr, you know, like Suhr Guitars, dear friends of mine, they're actually, the factory is right next to where I live, pretty much. I can walk there. Those are great too. Let's get on further here, because I kind of, you know, start going into details already. Which is your go-to guitar? Types of strings you use, picks. Do you have an effect collection? I do have an effects collection, but I hardly use it because everything in the boxes is meanwhile so good. I'm sorry to admit that, you know, but my oh my. But I do have, oh my gosh, I have some favorite guitars. Absolutely, I do. Well, here's right one of them, right? That's actually a Fender Custom Strat, you know, which is absolutely fantastic. I do have some really nice rare Tellies, one, two from 1970. One is like, you know, this wooden looking one, like the plain one, which is like really one of my favorite guitars, you know, that also one of the guitars I own the longest. And, but John Suhr built me a fantastic guitar, which is like, that's featured in some of the videos as well. Like there's a white Telly, you know, with a bunch of, you know, as a splittable humbucker. There's also like two single chords. You can have like, you know, five positions and also, you know, pickup splitters. And that guitar is very versatile. It feels very good. Then I have to point out Nick Huber built me an insanely good guitar called the Riedbergen, which is sort of like a 335. And that one, again, very versatile guitar. This one has a three position, but with two humbuckers that are both splittable, you know. So those are, I guess, you know, if my, God forbid, if something happens, earthquake, fire or whatnot, those are the two guitars probably right now I would grab, maybe along with my, you know, for nostalgic reasons, my one of the 1970 Tellies. Now the other one can come too. I'll take all of them. I think I have 50 guitars here or something like that. Anyhow, so Next one. Okay. I know that you're also good friends with John Suhr. Hey, see, obviously I kind of took that already away, didn't I? Do you own any Suhr guitars? Amps, effects, absolutely. I own a lot of their effects. This one guitar they built me and the amp and the head. I've always been curious about switching the pickups in my support. Oh, wow. And I'm wondering if you're familiar with the Suhr line and have experimented with them. Oh man, I tell you, they're building great guitars and especially pickups. Oh, another dear friend, Ed Yoon and Ola Strandberg, who built two guitars for me, an 8-string Strandberg and also a thin line 6-string. I have a bunch of regular thin line Fenders, but the 6-string Strandbergs are amazing too. I can only speak highly of those guitars as well. And John Suhr built also some of the pickups for some of those guitars. Fantastic pickups. I can't recommend them highly enough to you. Go and check out the Suhr pickups. Fantastic, really. So here we go. I know you play bass too, on your own, on my own productions. We need to see and hear more of you playing bass. Oh, thank you. I think you said playing guitar was self-taught. Was playing bass also self-taught? Yeah. Is your bass a jazz bass, and is there anything you can say about it? I have a bunch of bass guitars. I have two Ibanez ones. One is a 6-string, one is actually a 4-string. Then I have a jazz bass indeed. And then I have, which is an active one. And then I have actually a precision bass as well. I have to say that the jazz bass is a magic one. That's actually really, it sounds so nice. It plays so well and just so easy. So that's really my go-to bass. But honestly, I have to say, yeah, it's okay if I play it on my, you know, personal productions and stuff like that. But bass, you have to kind of train it. You have to be in shape, sort of, you know, because, you know, the strings are much bigger. You have to use different power to it, you know. So, for example, on the McStine-Minnemann albums, you know, most of the basses are really performed by Randy, you know. But yeah. Now I'm detouring the question a little bit. Yeah, but the Fender jazz bass rocks a lot. Okay. You endorse Steinberg and you use Cubase in your productions and carry a universal audio interface with you while on tour and use it to write sometimes. Absolutely. Oh, this might be a too open-ended question. But is there something in the workflow in terms of efficiency and templates you have set up that you can share? Any favorite plugins or maybe a specific Cubase feature that you cannot live without? Well, you know, working with, you know, your favorite music software or the music software that you've been known so well over all these years is obviously a little bit, it's like you already know what you're doing with it. You know, you get like, you know, so used to it, right? And it feels very comfortable working with it. So you grow, you know, together with the product, you know, and with the new plugins they put out. I just love Cubase. First of all, the audio engine sounds fantastic. You know, I think, you know, most of you know, the software, you know, companies, you know, have great, great devices there to offer and plugins and whatnot and sound. You know, the competition is too big, so you got to be good to stay on the market. Just once you decide for a program, it's just like good to keep going with it because, you know, you save, you know, all your settings for the songs and then you recall them and you do make templates, you know. For example, you know, with my Cubase settings, I have like all the templates that sounded good in the albums are saved. And sometimes I modify them a little bit, or if like, if I work with different drums or different settings, obviously, different instruments, then I kind of tweak a little bit here and there and do another setting, right? You know, another template. Plugins, oh man, you know, or features. I love the real-time transpose function, actually, in Cubase. It's just so easy to kind of, you know, just go directly into kind of things and edit them and make, like, you know, just create, like, great effects with it. What else? You know, like, plugin-wise, Universal Audio, for example, has, like, just fantastic plugins I would not want to live without. You know, for example, the whole artist series, you know, from you know, Chris Lord-Alge and the JJP ones, also like the Maserati ones, they're already great to mess around, for example, for tom-tom sums or floor tom sums, and then, you know, like compressions, you know, for the whole drum kit or something like that. That's what I actually use more. The Teletronics LA-2R, or sometimes a Distressor, you know, that kind of stuff. But then also I like, for the sum compression, you know, of the whole mix signal, the SSL compressor is fantastic, I think. It's the G-Bus, isn't it? I kind of, you know, try to, you know, yeah, my sister, for example, that album, I mixed everything myself, or on most of my albums I do. But it is great, you know, to kind of, I figured, leave the final step most of the time and kind of let someone else kind of with like fresh ears and objectivity kind of come in and listen to it again. So Forrester Savelle, for example, is like, you know, a great guy. He mastered the My Sister album. I mixed it and he mastered. For the McStine-Minnemann albums, we gave our mixes to Forrester, our you know, what we had already kind of set. And I think they sounded already kind of pretty close to what we wanted, but then he mixed it and mastered it. And the results are fantastic, you know. So meanwhile, when I kind of especially collaborate with people like Guthrie O'Brien and with Randy, that's when actually I kind of like to give away control. First of all, it's great because you can concentrate on the music, right? And you kind of give the signals as best as and provide them as best as you can, and then somebody else deals with it, and you can kind of just lean back and go like, cool, maybe this a little up, this a little down, a little effect over here and that and that. But working with Forrester is such a joy, you know, because he's a musician himself. He's a fantastic audio engineer. He has great musical ears. So, okay. Happy birthday. Thank you. I realize that it's your birthday coming up. Okay, here we go. As you're becoming a little older and wiser, thank you for saying that. what advice would you tell your younger self of 10 years younger, 20 years younger? The 20 years younger version, I would say, don't practice so much. Don't overdo it. Just kind of, you know, let the music talk. And even 20 years ago when I was writing music, there was still like this technical aspect there. You still had to sort of prove yourself. You had to let everything out to show the world what you can do. This is not necessary really anymore. But would I tell it, you know, to me as a 20-year younger person? Maybe I shouldn't, because without that learning experience, I wouldn't be there where I am now. So it was necessary to kind of put all these things out there, you know, but it was sometimes too much, you know. Albums like Comfortably Homeless, for example, my oh my, you know, there were like so many, it was so much fireworks in it, you know. It was sometimes a little too much, I thought. Meanwhile, yeah, we do have the fireworks, but we also have like really beautiful songs, because I guess, you know, the older you grow, the more you have to say, and it sounds richer. 10 years ago, what would I say? 10 years ago, that was not that long ago, man. That was like, you know, when I just started with the Aristocrats. Not much difference. I would kind of say, like, pay more attention to production and sound. That's like, you know, something you kind of learn with the experience, with experience, you know, by just watching other people, what we had early on, do what they do so brilliantly. And kind of, you know, pay attention to that. Be sensible about that. Okay. Oh, wow. Is it? No, it's more. Thanks for the links. There's links. Yeah. So, okay, here we go. I once asked Brian Beller the question about writer's block, and his response was that you've just got to make yourself do it and write and keep at it, even if it's crap. Is this something you agree? Yes and no. There are some songs, you know, that I have that are sitting around, and then you kind of, yeah, you kind of go like, no, let's kind of bring bring this to the end, you know, but there are some songs, especially on the first McStine-Minnemann album, that I thought, I have to kind of really admit that. There are some songs I had sitting for a while already, you know, and I couldn't kind of get further with them because I thought, it's not really good, but it has something that I really like about them. And that's when Randy came in. And he brought like something to it just by, you know, putting his voice, like literally his voice to it and kind of, you know, doing like a few textures here and there where I go like, now this comes to life. So some songs really benefit, you know, from having sometimes input from the outside. Ooh, that's a good song title. But usually, especially on McStine and Minnemann 2, my ideas were like fully formed and everything just, like I said, just flew out. I knew exactly where this is heading and what I wanted to do. Man, you know, that was cool. Yeah, but there are certain times, you know, when you have a song lying around and you go like, shit, okay, let's involve maybe someone else. But yeah, and then you kind of just make it happen as good as you can, you know. But usually, again, the songs unveil themselves and let you know whether they're worth working on. Okay, what are some of the latest drum sessions that you can talk about that you've played on? Maybe some of the talented artists that deserve more spotlight, such as Witherfall and Taku Yabuki. Good one. Are there others, maybe ones lesser known, that you can share? Oh man, what am I doing here right now? I'm doing, Terry Syrek was great, you know, but he's a known guitar player. You always have great productions. Lucas Lee, everyone. Yeah, Witherfall was really cool. That's the stuff that's coming out now. Taku Yabuki, right? What a talent. What a talent, you know, guy from Japan. And I posted some videos, you know, and broke the internet. It was fantastic. Great player. Yeah, he deserves more attention too, I think. Well, you know, he's getting there, right? I'm recording right now the second album together with Mari Hamada, very famous Japanese artist as well. She's been already kind of famous since the 80s, I think, or so, like, you know, especially in Japan. And I've been fortunate to record on two of her albums. One was released, I think, 2 years ago, and the other one is coming out next year. Who else? Oh, man, there's many musicians. There are, like, really, really cool players out there, you know. And I recently did a thing called, I forgot what were the artists called? The Megalodon metal song about the shark cartoon. It was fantastic. It was so funny and cool. Jan Rivera, right? You know, that guitar player from, I don't know where he lives. Is he on the East Coast? But man, that was very written. It's very well written stuff. A little bit like the Taku Yabuki thing. Like very, you know, modern composition and great stuff. So we're doing actually a thing. There's like a few more songs I'm working on with him right now for his new release. Half of it is already done. That is great too. So yeah. Okay. What was it like working with Adrian Belew? Well, fantastic. He's such a lovely fella. Great songs, good chemistry. We had this trio together with Julie Slick on bass and we toured the world. We recently played a show together in Chile, actually, as well, where I jumped in and played, actually, as a double drum thing with my friend Tobias Rolf, Indiscipline, that song. We were having a double feature there with the Aristocrats and Adrian. So, yeah, I love this guy. He's great. His birthday is one day before mine, on the 23rd. I'm on the 24th. Okay, one of the questions I was going to ask is whether there are... is any particular technique or anything technical drum-wise that you have been working on? From your Evidence of Humanity video interview with Mike Keneally, you did mention that you had a practice routine. But then I saw your solo in Buenos Aires and thought, okay, you know what? Forget that question. Well, thanks. No, well, you know, the thing is like, I don't really mean, well, you know, have a huge practice routine, you know. It's just that I... You know, I mean, I'm aware of the technique I'm using, but it's more like an alphabet. You know, you don't think about, you know, if there's like two L's in the word hello or something. You just talk. You just form different words, you know, sometimes, right? Or different sentences. So, no, I really kind of, look, I play so much, you know, and it's, I know that Guthrie would kind of, for example, say the same thing. You know, when people ask him about, like, hey, your practice routine, he was like, no, I don't really practice. Like, when we're on the road, we sometimes love to put our instruments down, enjoy the day, and then come back and enjoy the evening of playing. Go like, ah, there you go. And then after that, the last thing you want to do is, like, talk more about music. Then it's, you can do a few of those or what. But, so no, actually, what I do is I play like a long improvised solo every day. And then if something comes along that I like to explore, like cool lick or a cool ostinato or a cool technique, then I go like, oh shit, let's go into detail. But I'm not sitting there anymore going like, okay, let's do the same thing again. So here we go. No, it's more like speaking now. All right. What was it like working with Joe Satriani? That was great. It's, man, yeah, it's kind of, it's very simple, but also very effective. You know, songs like, you know, Flying in the Blue Dream, for example, fantastic. You know, if the stage sounds good and very rich, you know, it feels like a tank, you know. And it was a lot of showmanship as well. It's like very, I say it in the most respectful way, you know, but it's very old school rock and roll, right? You know, like a total production exactly designed that way, you know, a certain stage outfit and some videos here and there and stuff like that. And then you play and have fun. But great experience. Absolutely wonderful musicianship. Great people to work with. And man, I've been touring with this guy for 4 years or something. We did actually a double album. Sorry, Shockwave Supernova, and then also Behind the Shockwave, that video that came out. Whew. Yeah, good. Very good. Maybe some, he played on one of my albums as well, on Borrego. And then, I don't know, might be something coming up, you know, maybe in the future. You never know, you know, we kind of spread out always in many directions, you know. It's very cool. Having being on several tours with the great Joe Satriani. Is there any song from his vast back catalog that might not be as big of a crowd favorite that you secretly wished would have been performed live? Yeah, absolutely. Well, and we did. I loved the song, was it called something Down to Earth? No, what's the fuck? What was the song called? It went Not of This Earth. It was like, like this thing, and it starts with this, and then, you know, after a while, the drum groove kicks in, right? And it's like totally that. And then the bass comes in, and it's like, and, you know, in unison with another guitar. That song I loved, and I loved always playing it because it has such a cool buildup. Time Machine was another one I really enjoyed. Flying in a Blue Dream, I really enjoyed. Well, there's obviously, what's the thing? Satch Boogie, right? That's a classic. I don't know so much. I don't know so many songs of Joe. I'm so sorry, Joe, if you're watching this, I apologize. But, well, obviously I had to learn, what was the fun thing from Shockwave Supernova to play? There were many, many, many cool ones too. Something with Wings. What was it? Oh, I forgot the song titles now. That was like, you know, this really kind of cool groove song there as well. Yeah, anyways, you know, that's, yeah. Okay, cool. Oh, that was France. That was a cool song. That was really fun to play as well. Anything else? Man, you know, I have to kind of really kind of remember the Joe Satriani songs right now that we played, because I have to really openly admit that I never really listened so much to his stuff. Boom, 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 da-dum, dum, da-dum, dum, dum. Like the Putin on the Ritz song, what was that called? Like there was like one from the show, maybe that was even Shockwave Supernova, the song. It was cool too. Anyhow. So, if my memory serves me correct, I remember you've mentioned that you've... Oh, there's another Joe Satriani question. That you're aware of his Not of This Earth album when you first announced that you were going on tour. I know Joe might have said that the song The Enigmatic is weird, But I think it's such an incredible, awesome song. In any case, it was so cool to see Not Off This Earth performed. I think, you know, I'm responsible that the song was, like I said earlier in the program, because I like that song. And we played the other thing, I guess, too, once. We played a bunch of that album. Okay, cool. I also saw the Hellfest live videos, and there was so much power and energy in this performance. I think there were ones that ZZ shot or edit that were released. Those were super cool. Cool, awesome. One of the nicest things I have observed, particularly in the drumming community, is that everyone is always so supportive of one another and are always so encouraging. What was it like touring as part of a drummer trio with Terry Bozzio and Chad Wackerman? Yeah, that was good. Chad and Terry are longtime friends of mine, and we're exactly 10 years apart each other, you know, each from each other. Terry just had a 70th birthday, Chad 60, me 50. And, still the same glass of whiskey. It's like, meanwhile, almost 1.5 hours in. I'm a slow drinker. Holy cow, I need to kind of hurry up to get a little buzz. Anyhow, oh, that was great, you know, so especially because like Terry is like a very, you know, and it shouldn't sound bad, you know, don't get me wrong. I remember we sat him in the middle of it, you know, and Chad were, you know, facing each other from that direction. So we had like a sort of triangle, because Chad already pointed it out, because Chad has worked with Terry earlier than I have, you know, already. And he said like, yeah, because... And Terry explained, he goes like, see, I grew up listening with Miles Davis and not, and those bands. And also when he played with Frank, maybe later Frank Zappa and stuff, but he grew up pretty much in the 60s and then early 70s. And he says like, there were no such thing as really click tracks in the studio and whatnot. So he was used to kind of, you know, adopt the tempo sometimes, you know, not in a sloppy way, like just in a pace. And Chad and I, we grew up pretty much with click tracks and the whole world, you know, so, you know, sometimes when we would do something that, you know, needed a certain accuracy, like playing in sync or something, Terry would literally ask like, or we would listen to Terry where he's going with his time to kind of follow, that we would really lock. Again, that's not a thing, you know, I hope that doesn't come across the wrong way, you know, and it by all means, absolutely not. But there is this kind of thing, Chad and I, we would have this very, you know, time thing kind of, you know, with being locked to a click track most of the time. So we had pretty solid time on this, on stage. And but Terry, that was a cool thing. He would sometimes want to fluctuate and go like, and so you have to agree on listening to someone who's doing that. And in that case, you know, that was an experience I really enjoyed, you know. The other thing I really enjoyed was when Terry and I, we both had a, not a drum battle, but sort of a thing, fun one, obviously, playing next to each other. And I was closing my eyes, and when we would play, and I would do a fill, he would do a fill, and then we would trade always forth and back. And at some point, he would do his like his typical Terry sound with those crashes, just Chinese crashes, like, and then all this kind of stuff, or the China crashes, the stacked ones. And then I opened my eyes and looked at him and smiled, because it sounded so much like Terry, obviously, but it was like just like when I realized, it's like, fuck, this can be only Terry. So I kind of, you know, looked at him and smiled, and he starts smiling at me too and goes like, you know, and then later on, he kind of comes to me and goes to the backstage, my God, he goes, because the audience started laughing too. And we're like, oh, this is so fun. This is so cool. And then Terry goes like, man, thank you, Marco, for doing this, because, you know, I think I never ever smiled really on stage. I did that. And all of a sudden we did this fill and he looked at me and started smiling, and I smiled back, and I realized, oh my God, I'm so serious all the time. Thanks for bringing that out of me. And I was like, wow, really? That's so cool. Thank you. You know, thank you for being Terry, because you brought that smile on my face just kind of in that particular moment. So that was an endearing story, I think, you know, for me as well. So here we go. Are there any talks for more LMR collaborations? LMR is Lyrical Rudis. I think the... We all know who the players are. And, maybe. Because, you know, we all wrote pretty much, you know, the songs also separately in our respective homes and then brought them together and completed them. And I think Lyrical Rudis 1 and 2, the second one was called From the Law Offices of Lyrical Rudis, had, like, great moments there. We never played as a live trio, you know, in that setting. We played together live in other settings, you know, but I played with Tony Levin in the UK, and I played with John Rudess on the musical Mind Meld. But we should probably kind of collaborate more, maybe in this trio setting or in other settings. You know, we always do. We always find each other, you know.
Mm.
I finished my sip of whiskey. Can you believe it? After 1.5 hours. Do I need more? I don't know. So, there's another page. Now that you are back writing new material, great views of the lake, I must say, thanks. Is there anything you can share? Which context band it is for? Solo album, another collaboration, The Aristocrats' Secret. It's no secret about this. I'm pretty dedicated moving forward and writing about for McStine-Minnemann. It's, for me right now, the dream collaboration. We did two albums that we're really happy with. And I'm very proud, and I know Randy is too, of what we did. And that shouldn't sound, hopefully not sounding self-indulgent, you know, because we really did this with love and passion and with great companionship, you know. Like, it was like just great friendship between us, or is, you know. We talk every day, you know, and are just respectful and to each other, and so I would like to keep this thing going and form a band with it, and I know Randy does too. So we're working actually on a third album already, and then we are planning to go on the road. So that's what I'm writing for. That's what I'm living for right now. It's almost like a solo project for me as well, and for Randy too, because we both bring our solo works into this picture, and it seems to get, I don't know if the word better is the right word, but it seems to succeed, not only sales-wise, but also succeed in this collaboration. That's what we talked about earlier with the, you know, the objectivity factor. You know, two heads are better than one sometimes, isn't it? And so when we bring songs to each other, we, you know, we can lean back and watch the others do their magic, you know, vice versa, you know what I mean, you know? And that's fantastic. It works great. It's never pressure. It's always fun. So, well, this is where I kind of, you know, fill in a second sip and drink to our new dear band. There we go. This is for Randy. And for you too, Lucas. Okay. No, this is great, you know. Thank you, you know, for the very knowledgeable questions and for the details that you also know. I kind of really enjoyed that talk, and I really appreciate if when somebody knows what they're talking about, you know what I mean? And you're a great musician, Lucas, you know. I love working with you, and always when you send your albums over and I'm putting drums to them, it's such a great thing, and you always seem happy with it. There's like hardly ever a moment where you come back and go like, hey, we need to redo this, or can you do that or this? It's always like I send you something back and you go like, oh, cool, awesome, thank you. It's like, you maybe when I do something, yeah, I don't know, it's fine, I love what you do. It's like, wow. So we have great chemistry too, you know. So I really enjoy that. So on that note, another toast. And I guess I'm signing off. All right, my friend. Have a good night. Cheers.
I want to thank Marco again for doing this interview and being so generous with his time. Him sharing his personal stories, wisdom, life perspectives, and approaches he uses in his work. Also, a quick shameless plug. Marco has played on my recent 3 albums. If this is something that might fancy your interest, you can find out more by visiting LucasLeeMusic.com. I will post some of the video links that we discussed during this interview session up on my website. Please also feel free to subscribe to my YouTube channel and share this video to friends that you think might be interested. I have another interview in the works that I will also be posting. Thank you for watching.